BBC Radio Nottingham.
So next week, it's somewhat of a holy week. I guess it's been somewhat of a holy week this week as well. But for Hindus across Nottinghamshire, it's a week full of colourful clothes, dandiya sticks, and eating lots and lots of sweets. So that's just the tip of the iceberg of the celebrations for Navratri, Dussehra, and Durga Puja. Yes, I'm just checking I got the list right again. So Durga Puja specifically is about celebrating the ultimate goddess Durga in all her feminine power. And somebody who wants you to embrace your inner goddess is local psychotherapist and yoga teacher Lina Mukherjee, who joins you now. So Lina, how exactly can one embrace their inner goddess?
Well, thank you first of all for having me on, Hans. So how can one embrace their inner goddess? To know it's there is number one. To assume it's there, and then to practice it. But it's about connecting in, that you have agency and you have power.
How would you know it's there, though? Because I don't know, I've never heard from, does it talk to you? What is it? Is it
if
like
I would, well, it's interesting you ask it, because I think it's a very, very important question. And how I see it, Hamza, having been in both cultures, it's when you speak your truth.
Okay.
So there's no right and wrong, there's no doubting, there's no sort of, oh, what do you think? It's just, actually, it feels right. When something feels right, not on an emotional level only, it's deeper than that. It goes from your gut to your heart, to then your brain to say, yep, that's right. So it meets you on all levels, your psychological, your emotional, and your spiritual.
So why is it important to connect with your inner goddess?
It's very, very key, because as I was sharing earlier, that at this time of the year, this month now, for so many Hindus around the world, and non-Hindus, because people are celebrating, it's a time of tuning into that consciousness and being brought up as a Bengali Brahmin's daughter, because my father was a Brahmin priest. We were really taught to revere the immortal goddess. So we'd look at the murti, dad would bring it alive, everybody get excited, and then it would all close down after 4 days. But I didn't as a child, because I thought, actually, there's more than this. There's a magical quality, and it's a capital M, where it was more in terms of a sense of moreness, the sense of more greatness, the more sense of aliveness, the more of potential. And how do we actualize that? That's why it's so key that we don't sort of abdicate our responsibility to the priest, to the church, to teachers, to our elders, to our parents, but actually there's something about us living that as a mortal life, but that actually we're more than just human. We are greater than that.
So this time, I mean, there's some sort, I'm sensing some sort of connection here to kind of, to mental health.
Yes.
And to a very, to a healthy mind.
Yes.
And a healthy state of being. It's all very spiritual, and there's a connection there, isn't there?
Yes.
Now, mental health is something that we often talk about on this programme, and there appears to be, is something that we seem to hear that people from South Asian community just don't, there seems to be a stigma.
Yes.
So, in your experience of speaking to people, especially South Asian women, what do you think is the biggest barrier for that South Asian women when it comes to talking about mental health, about spirituality, that sort of thing?
Well, a really key question, and I experience from my work and both my early life that it's to do with shame, that there's a sense of non-perfection, and with physical health you can do something about it. Mental is, it's the shame, it's the stigma, there's some, as I said, some imperfection. You won't then become marriageable, you're imperfect in some way, so it's to be hidden. But a lot of it is shame driven, that there's something wrong and you can't admit that there is some mental wrongness in the self, and that often is what drives people to ignore, to keep it quiet, to keep it a secret, because the fear of being found out, to be imperfect.
What do you tell people, you know, that you meet who feel that way?
Well, I offer a non-judgmental attitude, a compassionate attitude, to say, actually, why use the label mental illness? And for example, yes, you know, they become labels to define the person, whereas actually what I then invite clients to do is to talk about how they're feeling. Who's given that judgment in a negative aspect, whereas actually there may be a troubling sense, a suffering sense that may stem from something that has happened, and that's what I'm more interested in, is what has led to this, and what do they think, more importantly, not what others think. So it's about empowering that individual to own what is going on, and not to be ashamed. That it's suffering, that it doesn't define them.
It's really difficult when you've been brought up in a family or a culture that you just don't talk about it. It's just not the thing. You know, and once they maybe leave that space that they've had that really sort of like a comfortable atmosphere with you, they're able to, once you leave that space, you can't help but think that everything just kind of goes back to normal.
And that's, again, a very good point and astute point you've raised, Hans. So what I tend to hear, the feedback that I receive, is they take my room with them. They take me with them. It's a sense of that experience of being non-judged, feeling accepted in totality, and feeling safe. Once you feel safe, it's amazing what changes can begin to happen. And that sense of shame, that sense of hiding, that sense of humiliation, rejection, and all those fears that can result as a result of these judgments tend to then dissipate. And you start to access the strength within that actually, I'm okay. I need to work on whatever is happening, but it doesn't scar me, it doesn't define me. So they take that experience with them, and it's amazing what transformative action can happen as a result.
Do you think enough people are talking about mental health?
I think it's happening more, which is fantastic. And even you and I having this conversation now is brilliant, and it's on air, it's live. I think there needs to be more, which is why I do what I do, both in terms of the privacy of my own consulting room, but also to come out and talk about it, because again, I've experienced it myself. I work with a lot of people from all colours and creeds. It's really vital, but more needs to be done.
And what a time to do it during Durga Puja. So I know that you've got your embracing your goddess workshop, but what else can people get involved with over the course of the next few weeks?
Okay, well, last Wednesday was World Mental Health Awareness Day. Fantastic, you know, you're asking about it. It's on the world scene, so that's great. And in conjunction with Nottingham Central Library and Libraries Week this week, we are running three more workshops in terms of mental health and wellness. Not mental illness, it's wellness. Particularly looking at stress, on how to learn about your body, how to learn very simple techniques in terms of regulating stress levels that actually make life worth living.
Fantastic. So if you want to find out more about those workshops or the workshop that Lena's got, which is called Embracing Your Goddess, that one is on Saturday the 27th of October from 4:30, and you can find out more about that and all the other workshops by visiting praxis-yoga.com. Lena, thank you so much for coming on this evening.
Tomorrow morning.